Well, I'm so pleased to be here with Nora van der Linden, who's from Kennisland. And that is an organization I have long admired. It was a real pioneer in thinking through, I suppose, public innovation, but it did many, many other things. But over the years, it's done an incredible amount of projects. And one thing I always found quite amusing, that it started up an organization called the Kafka Brigade, which is a beautiful name, and that organization has now gone independent. So what I'm really interested in, Nora, just tell me a bit about the background of Kennisland before you do your presentation about some of the projects you're doing now currently.
Yes, hi Charles, thank you for the invitation. I'm also very pleased to be part of your festival. Kennisland started in 1999, more than 20 years ago already. And it was in a time when a lot of money was spent on logistics and distribution, and a lot of train lines were being made in the Netherlands to be able to distribute goods in Europe. And there were a few guys who said we shouldn't invest so much in train lines and distribution and logistics. We should actually be investing in knowledge and a knowledge economy. So they coined this term knowledge economy and said, what if we start investing more in people instead of in things and stuff? And that will actually be much better for the economy and also for the well-being of people in the Netherlands. And that's when they started Kennisland, which means knowledge land, knowledge nation. They said the Netherlands should be a knowledge land. And that's how it all started.
All right. And over the years, you've done quite a few projects. There was to do with knowledge, but you also did other things to do with, I don't know, cultural heritage. You did quite a range of types of issues, didn't you, over the years, and digitization and stuff.
So actually, we started with this knowledge economy and also with the idea that investing in knowledge will also grow the economy, and a growing economy is also better for people. So the idea of sort of like trickle-down effect well-being if you invest in knowledge. And it was more also lobbying and focusing on policy. But the idea developed that we need the collective intelligence of society to work on social issues. So we more and more developed into actually not the idea of knowledge economy, but knowledge society. And how can you use all this experience and knowledge of society, but also, and that was more the cultural heritage and the digitalization part of Kennisland, how to open up knowledge that is there and use your heritage also and make it available to people. So we worked a lot with archives to digitize their what they have on paper. How can we also make that available for people? So that's where we did a lot of this kind of work. And over the years after, we really focused more on this knowledge society idea and how can we really develop more methods and approaches to work with people and also empower people to be able to change their own work, life, environment. And this is where we are right now, that we really innovate and work together with people to make people change makers and influence policy, not from like this top-down idea of trickle-down effect, but really how can we trickle up and work people in society. And we are sort of like a broker in between and use all these different methods, social innovation approaches, to facilitate that.
Yeah, no, I think the main interesting thing is that you're really talking about a major transformation. And in the context of our festival, the fact that you were dealing with all these transformations has implications for incentives and regulations and all of this sort of stuff. But why don't you just tell us a bit, you've got a presentation, which I think is very interesting, about some of your recent projects and also a past one that I think our audience would love to hear about. So over to you with your presentation.
Yes. So as I said, we work with people and for people, and this is I'm showing just some examples of people we work with. This is Farid, who's a teacher and who really wants to improve education, has a lot of ideas on how he can collaborate better with his fellow teachers in his school. This is John, a guy we met in a nursing home, who still has many dreams and really wants to achieve things in his life, like building beautiful castles. But that has been very complicated because these nursing homes are not really designed for old people having dreams. And this is a group of people who work on the energy transition. But it has been very, very complicated to work together with the municipality because there are so many regulations and it has been very difficult to work with civil servants on the energy transition. So actually what we ask ourselves is, why do these people get stuck in the system and why does it work against them instead of support them and support their talents and qualities and competencies? And how can we get unstuck? So how can we really use this all these qualities of people and design continuous learning processes to support this learning? So Kennisland, as I said, since 1999, we work with different types of people on different topics, education and young people, care and health, and government in transitions. But as we said, over the years, we've worked on many different topics all about knowledge society. How can we use all the collective intelligence and experience and expertise to work on these big societal transitions? And we often start with the question, what is a good life and for whom? So we really start with people. And as we already discussed a bit or talked about a bit, we used to start with lobbying and changing policy back in 1999 in the hopes that this new policy would really trickle down and have an effect on the daily practice and the daily lives of people. And we were, of course, quite successful many times, but we really found that this trickle-down effect didn't happen enough and didn't influence practice and people enough. So in addition, we started to develop a lot of projects to support professionals to experiment with new approaches and enhance their own innovative capacities within existing systems. So for example, we organized learning networks for teachers and policymakers. And of course, this has had an effect, and often teachers were happier with their teaching practice and with their schools, but we still questioned ourselves, how are citizens and end users affected by this? Is the education better if teachers are happy? You hope so, but we said, okay, we really also want to work with people and enable people also to be part of policy design and based on their stories and their engagement and to see how can we also work on this bottom-up, trickle-up effect. And what we found out, of course, is that we actually need this whole system to work together. So policy and practice and people are all important. And we start with the perspective of the end user, of the people, and we include their experience and talents and use that as a starting point for change. So that is actually our main focus and starting point, but we definitely also still work with professionals and with civil servants and policymakers all along the way. So I promised to say a bit more about a few of our projects, three projects. One is about education. And this is a project we started a few years ago with the municipality of Amsterdam. It was assigned by the municipality of Amsterdam. And the question came actually from this like changing demography in Amsterdam. More and more families were staying instead of leaving the city. And there was a need for more schools. And the municipality said, okay, how can we support new schools instead of working with the school boards? How can we come up with something else? And we said, okay, this is a really interesting and challenging question. If you want that, you really need to open up to society if you want something else. So we challenged them to come up with a challenge. So that we could really use all this collective intelligence of the unusual suspects who are not involved in education yet and in setting up new schools. And that we did that because we said, if you want radical innovation in the education system in the city, that doesn't come from existing organizations. So we wanted to give the city residents the chance to design and set up schools themselves. And we designed this open crowdsourcing instrument, this challenge, a learning system around it, so change makers and civil servants could learn together. And make this bottom-up innovation visible and also show it's possible. And we also made sure that all these like system players like Ministry of Education, the academic world, and also the inspection of education were on board. So we designed a process with a challenge, with a first selection with judges and an online voting. So it was really up to the city also to decide what kind of schools do we actually want in this city, and what kind of education is needed for Amsterdam kids. Then there was this incubator phase, there was a second selection, and then there was this kraamkamer in Dutch, which was like nursery. So we could really, with all these different stakeholders, use all the knowledge, also the systems knowledge, but also the innovation knowledge to set up new schools. And the promise of the elder man of education was we're going to really establish new schools. So four new schools were established at the end of this process. This was how it looked like. You could vote. These are some of the schools that were that won actually at the end. 15 school makers were guided by Candice Nunn through a 6-month process. Where we gave them like inspiration, but also what kind of design tools they needed, what kind of implementation, what do you need for implementation if it comes to the school. And these are the winners, together with the alderman of education, who actually after that really had to set up the schools. So this was after this, there were like ideas with a lot of support, plans to set up the school, and then they made it happen with the support of the municipality. The results of the challenge is that we received a lot of plans and a lot of ideas. It really sparked a citywide discussion on what kind of education do we need. So we also organized a lot of events around it to really discuss and what kind of innovation do we need in the school system. A lot of like online support and votes. And like what kind of results now actually sustained. So we have four new schools in Amsterdam. It was also really an impulse for the existing system of school boards to think about, okay, they were being challenged by these new schools and all these new people. It was also often a combination of people that started the new school. So it was parents, teachers, students, entrepreneurs, and that formed these groups that started the new schools. And at the end, there's also been new legislation because the Ministry of Education also was part of this, and it passed the parliament. There's the new legislation, which is called More Room for New Schools, and it became easier for new initiatives to start a new school. And also, not in the Netherlands, you have to say you're based on whether a religion or a school vision, and that's also now been changed. So you can say, I just have an innovative idea, and it's not religious, and it's not like Montessori or Jena or anything. You can also say it's just my own vision or with this group of people, and you need enough signatures of parents. So that's really nice. So it's parents who really need to put their signature, like, okay, this is what we want as parents for children. And it started in June 2021, just a few months ago. Okay, another project. I'm just moving on. So this is not about the beginning of lives, beginning of education, but this is really about end of life and building a new and positive movement around growing old better, a movement of pioneers who have an innovative vision for nursing care for elderly homes. So the question is, like, we live in this aging society, and there's often like broader sad predictions about the future of an like older society and the care that is needed, but it's not there. So we said we want to change the perspective and talk about radical new ideas about growing old, and in a nice way and in a way that uses still the talents of old people. Also, if we need care and support, but how can it look different than it is now? So in 2020, we supported 12 pioneers from society. So again, with this challenge and a campaign, we focused on anyone with good idea for getting older in a better way. And in 2021, we focused on pioneers from care organizations. So from people more within the system who have ideas about new ways for getting older. And we would support them with Changemaker program, peer learning, coaching, and a budget to also be able to do this. So not only in their own spare time, but also be able to buy some time to work on the projects. So these are some of the pioneers from the first program. Some people from many places in society who have worked last year on their projects. And we also have a board of elderly people who call themselves something like the grannies, who give feedback on the projects and also help us with really focusing on what do older people need instead of doing that from a younger perspective. The bigger picture is that we want to build a movement for a lifelong living. We want to involve healthcare organizations and work on innovation culture, changing policies. But we also do work with the healthcare workers themselves, also on what kind of tools and what kind of skills do you need to innovate in your own organization and in a culture that's not used to innovate. Well, this is the timeline. That's not, it shows that it's really a movement with different, like with ambassadors, with campaigning, with challenges, different challenges for different people, different places in the country. We help these people with sort of like journey along the lines of design thinking, empathize, define, ideate, test, prototype and test, to really also inspire them to work different than they used to. So the outcomes, so this is still running. We are still working with the pioneers as we speak. And the outcomes, we try to imagine a better and different future for older people, for when we all grow older. Finding solutions also in an aging society, positive solutions. Support pioneers and innovators with their ideas, and also connect them to organizations to be able to scale so that they're not isolated too much. creating a movement around innovating elderly care. So the pioneers can also find each other and also support the Ministry of Healthcare, because they're, this is an assignment from them on how to use these kind of open innovation tools and use the knowledge of society. And not all solutions need to come from them, but that we can really also rely on the knowledge that we have in society. Okay, the last project, it's something that we just started up. So it's just a taster and we don't know yet exactly. I cannot say anything about results yet, but it's like, we call it like a testing ground to report discrimination. So it was also a question from the Ministry of Social Affairs and Labour Market, and they asked us what kind of solutions can we design to increase the willingness to report discrimination among the Muslim community. This reporting discrimination, it's a complex and sensitive problem. And the ministry showed us that they really want to experiment and learn with new approaches, which is great, I think, and also quite vulnerable to say, okay, this is complex. We don't know. We don't know what to do, because we see that it's difficult to reach these communities and work with them, but we do want to reach out. So what we're doing is designing a learning community around this topic with very different stakeholders, and create an inclusive and equal space to discuss this topic and also see what are the problems behind the problem. And we try to work with the method and tools that are subtle, because that's what's needed when it's such a complex and wicked problem. And what we actually try to do is kind of like inclusive policymaking. So see how can we open up and also inspire the ministry to create policy in a different way. We use this like double diamond research approach. It's based on design thinking. I'm sure some of you know what it is, where we have all these steps and we guide all the members of this learning community to work on this design thinking. It's really also based on, this is an empathy canvas, right? So I'm showing it because I think it's so important to really understand from the perspective of the people who really are discriminated and their experiences. And that's what we often do in many of our projects. We work with stories and not personas, but really the stories of the people who encounter difficulties. Because that's inspiring you also to work on different kind of solutions. And I think that's needed for these kind of very important and challenging issues that we have, like discrimination. So I hope to tell you more about that when we finish the project. So perhaps a few takeaways for what works for us for now. We really focus on this collective intelligence. We seduce people, as you saw. We try to also design these kind of campaigns to make it attractive, also to build this positive movement. We really support the innovators also at the margin, so we try to also find these unusual suspects. We always work on innovation competencies, really on the how, what can you do. We not only co-research people, but also the entire process, also co-analyze. So it's not us who make an analysis of stories of others, it's really also collective process and a collective analysis that we make with people. I think that's very important. And we do that because we think it's so important to also define and reframe the problem together and not have like an academic or policy definition of the problem and then invite some people to work on it and then we go further. No. The entire process should be collective, and use creativity as a force for change. That's also something that we work a lot with, also social designers, with artists along the way. And there's also struggles, of course. Time is always a problem when you work with professionals and citizens. There's not enough time. It's like the truly co-create the entire process. We really focus on that, but how do you make sure that you live up to it? how do we scale outcomes, or should we scale process, and how do we do that? That's always an issue. How to deal with politics? There's always politics, especially also these sensitive topics like discrimination, but also elderly care. It's also, where do we spend money on? Who's in charge? And do we still have time to experiment, to tinker around while the world is burning? So there's also this time, this pressure. And how can we keep pioneering? Also, as Kenneth Lund, like more and more people talking about social innovation and design thinking, action research. And then we also wonder what's next and how can we also make this movement of people that work on this bigger and bigger. Yeah, so this is, I think, I hope enough to discuss, Charles, with you. I'm sure you have some questions about this.
Well, what I found quite interesting is a couple of things. That you're getting the stuck unstuck was great. The whole notion of flipping and switching the perspective and not dealing with existing organizations. And then finally, given that you're always being a pioneer, how can you stay a pioneer? So perhaps that's my one question. How can you stay a pioneer given that you have been a pioneer? That's always very difficult.
Yeah. Well, I think it's also the consciousness of being a pioneer and also feeling the obligation also to think about what's next. I think that's the first step. So now and as you already also mentioned, the Kafka Brigade, for example, what we often do is we set up something and we try to find the right partners also to take it further, and then we step out again. So what we don't do is endlessly, when something is successful, we're like, okay, great, it is successful, we pass it on and we'll work on the next thing that's needed. So I think that's one of the things you have to do if you want to stay a pioneer. You don't want to get stuck yourself in something that's successful, but you want to pass it on to other organizations that take it further, that can scale it, that can learn from it, and then we're looking for the next thing.
So I think that's really great. So you're like a research and development organization, an experimenter for society as a whole. I mean, looking at the projects you did, rethinking a school, rethinking elderly care, and now tackling that difficult issue of discrimination, you are in a sense being pioneering, I think, because that's that last project you discussed is not a usual thing, you know, that a ministry would say, we might be ourselves not very good at doing this, help us. So I'm sure there are other topics which you, with your very sharp eyes, will identify. That's been a really interesting journey that you've just described, and I think it's really very impressive. So I'm looking forward to, and speaking to you again, about the next pioneering initiative that I have no idea what it could be. So thank you very much, Nora, for the conversation and your presentation. That's great.
Well, thanks, Charles. It was a pleasure.